Would you like to support Cubs Out Loud? One way is to join us over on Patreon. For as little as a buck a month, patrons get early access to our shows, the pre and post show, and various other rewards. You can learn more at patreon.com/cubsoutloud. Thanks to all of our patrons for their support in making this podcast. November 13th, 2022. I'm Jeff. And
who's your bear? That's right. I am your bear.
I'm Damon.
I don't brew the tea. I just serve it.
And that makes me Gary.
Everyone else is thinking it, and I just say it.
Welcome to Cubs Out Loud, the Bear Podcast. It's been turning around length, episode number 671. And we have the Cubsies on the show.
Yay! Hi.
Yay!
Tony is back for with us because, hey, guess what, folks? We're doing it again.
Can we get kinky tonight? I got so many things on my mind.
All right, that's enough before we get like a copyright.
We'll get flagged.
I mean, the nice thing is most of these are like, hey, you're playing this music, so you can't make any ad revenue from this. And guess what? We don't make avenue revenue from any of it anyways because we don't have enough subscribers. Don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe, and ding that bell. Thank you.
Ding!
Gary, what's so kinky about this week?
Well, obviously, Tony's with us, so I mean... What more could you really want? I had reached out because...
A bunch of dildos, some lube.
A fuck machine. Anyway, so...
I mean, maybe post...
Tony, this isn't a scavenger hunt. You're not supposed to look around your house and, like, check off all the items that we just listed that you have.
Oh, I'm suddenly wondering, like, what do I have sitting behind me on the screen?
What can I grab?
So it's a Let's Talk About Kink series because, so once upon a time, bears, cubs, admirers, and more around the world enjoyed turning the pages of hard copy print magazines until the pages stuck together. This was something that came around from the 60s through the beginning of the 2000s, and then the internet appeared on the scene, and it shifted focus from where we got our smut. In 2007, we saw the landscape change with the turning of a mobile phone into this thing called a smartphone. And soon after, paper pages are replaced by swiping and sexting. So over a decade since the iPhone's debut, the once very much enjoyed and popular Drummer Men adult magazine appears to be coming back on the scene. So the question is there an audience for a quote-unquote zine, there's a throwback term, be it online with a print option? So while we're talking a little bit about Drummer Magazine, I think in this conversation we're just going to talk about, like, smut for, like, the broader community. Because this was a part of our experience, like, how you found a community, how you connected with a community, how you baited to said community was you went and found a print copy, whether it was like hidden somewhere in the outdoors or under a bed in like another family member's home, in the garage, at the neighborhood clubhouse. And then eventually when you became of age, you just went into like a store and bought it, got a subscription and... like had it mailed to your home. But you know, the landscape changed right on technology and we move forward. And now, you know, I mean, we've got these mini little computers in our hands and we just kind of like, you know, press a couple buttons and boom, dick. So.
It is that true. It is that simple.
I mean, I don't find any of this funny because all of it's true.
I just think it's the way that it has been described is funny.
You're welcome. So Yeah, honestly, what happened was a couple weeks ago, I was made aware that Drummer magazine is kind of coming back, and that as a media company, they're celebrating 25 or 25 plus years, and they had a recent issue called The Bear Issue. This is how it kind of came up on my radar. And this is kind of a little bit dated because it's from 2021 and we're now in 2022. Former staff member of Bear Magazine, Luke Mauerman, I think that's how you pronounce his last name, has a nice little kind of like op-ed article. It's actually dated January 1st of this year. So here we are, obviously, in November, but it was a little interesting from a nostalgia aspect. I think Lou does a very specific kind of viewpoint. He fills in some of the gaps in what happened with Bear Magazine and afterwards. But it just really kind of got me thinking about this concept that is there a community, is there a desire from us to support this kind of thing? Because I think that's been a struggle a little bit in terms of like having connectedness. I mean, we've had The Advocate for quite some time, obviously. And there's been some other print publications that have come and gone. Newer ones have arisen on the scene. But I find this interesting that it's one that we all probably have some understanding of from the past, even if we weren't really a subscriber to it.
There were a bunch of them. It wasn't just like Drummer. There was a...
Right.
Boy, I'm trying to think of like... You mentioned Advocate. There was Out. There was there was the I forget the name of the guide that gave you locations across the Damron. Country. Thank you.
You're welcome. I remember it because it's close to my name.
Oh, that would have made sense. But I mean, we had all kinds of different media, and it was a different time because, again, like with the Damron, if you had to go look up where you could find some place that was gay friendly to stay. With magazines, there really wasn't a whole resource for you to be able to get smut at the time, other than your local video store or buying said magazines at said local video store.
I mean, it's rather interesting the where like it, I guess I would call it a decline in the beginning, because it started out like, I remember, so Damon remembers when he was like young and his brothers, he had older brothers that were 7 years older than him. So they were hitting puberty and doing all the things and finding all the magazines. And we lived in a neighborhood where like, it was a wonderful breadth of ages. So everyone kind of had like, you know, people that they could hang out with. And I remember they were, you know, obviously high school, you know, age, and were grabbing, like finding the magazines and the porn, like wherever. There was a home in the neighborhood where the family left suddenly. We don't know what happened. I don't know the story. I still don't know to this day what happened, but they left the house suddenly. And someone was able to, for lack of a better phrase, break into the house, and they found a box of like porn. And now this was like, you know, the Playboy and the Penthouse and all of that stuff and other magazines. And I remember them being so excited about finding all this stuff. And then, you know, obviously the younger ones of us were told to stay away, but did we? No, we never do. So we found our own. And it was kind of this whole like taboo, like no one talks about it, but we know where it is. You know how to find it. You know how to get to it. And then fast forward to my buying my first ever gay porn mag while I was on choir tour from a Christian college in Canada. I bought two magazines. They were actually I was going to say stuck together, but that, no. They were
sold together.
Sold together. Thank you. They were sold together in like a, you know, like a plastic bag, and you know, and I found it so interesting the way that it was sold to me. And I remember it to this day. It was literally like I put them on the counter. The guy scanned it. I paid the money. He then took the magazines and put them in this brown, like, paper bag, completely, like, obscuring anything that was in it. And then he said, thank you and have a good day. And then he literally ushered me out because he was like, okay, you get to go. Because, you know, yeah. And this was just a – that was just a – adult bookstore. I will remember that one because it was not one of the like movie it wasn't a video store. It was definitely an adult bookstore. And then fast forward to moving up here to Cincinnati and the Pyramid downtown, the Pink Pyramid was what it was originally called. And it was a bookstore, but they sold everything, but it was the gay like bookstore. And being super happy that it was there because, one, it was not that far from where I worked. I could walk to it. And it allowed for me an opportunity to see more. It was where I saw my first Bear magazine, going back to the article. And really, really kind of learning more about what I found attractive. Mm-hmm. Seeing all of this porn from the days, and even the magazines I bought, the main reason I got them wasn't because I was attracted to anything in there. It was more that it was porn and it was gay, and that's all I needed at that point in time, because I wasn't getting much anywhere else.
Did either of you two subscribe to the magazines?
I did later as an adult. I think once I don't know if it was after I moved out of the house, but I moved out pretty late. So because I remember I bought for quite a while, but I did end up subscribing to Brush Creek Media at some point with Bear Magazine. But it's interesting you say that, tell that recollection, Damon, because I remember going to the bookstore and buying the 2-packs. And I would get annoyed because sometimes the 2-pack, I wouldn't buy it because I'm like, I'm not interested in the one magazine. Like, it's surfer, pretty boy, like hairless, tan, Adonis, like models on the front. And then the other one that they stuck with it was some trade, magazine publication. It's either Drummer or something else. It's very like kind of, leather kink, bear, very masculine, hardcore.
Right.
Once in a while you would get blessed and it was like a double pack. So it might be like, a Bear magazine with Drummer or some other international publication you never heard of. Like I have a copy of something called Trucker. It's like the very first issue or whatever. It was from Europe. And I was like, the hell? I kind of was a part of that. But I mean, again, this is in the midst of the birth of the internet when it was in its infancy, we were doing stupid shit, like trying to download JPEGs and have them print on dot matrix printers and, just crazy crap like that.
Oh, yeah. And that was the thing though. And as we're kind of like bringing like that was the way it was back, I hate saying it, back in my day kind of thing, but that's kind of how I feel about it. Like print media and even with the internet, if you wanted to see that picture again, you either had to print it or maybe save it somewhere. And then, we didn't have a whole lot of, memory on the computer back in the day. And if you're using like a public computer, like I was when I was in, I was at Northern Kentucky University for Governor Scholars, and I couldn't really click and save the pictures on this public computer. So I would, clandestinely, print off these pictures that I found attractive just because I didn't have any other way to save them anywhere else. And
yeah, that's why you sort get in those like 10 packs of floppy disks.
Yeah.
And this was probably in the day.
I got some of those in my basement.
So they weren't really floppy. They were just like a hard plastic thing. But
right. Yeah.
Three and a half. Yeah.
They were like, 14K or something like that?
Wow. That's some nostalgia.
I got every form of media. Well, mainstream media. I'm sure Tony's got probably more than I do. But I have I'm pretty sure I have 5 1/4s and 3.5s and low to high level USB like flash drive type things.
Wow.
And now external drives as well. So yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I was looking around my desk because I actually have a USB floppy drive here somewhere.
Wow.
I had to use it recently.
Yeah. I didn't subscribe to magazines because I did not really have an opportunity. Because I was living at home, then I was living in a college dorm, then I was living with people in a intern house, and I was living with a roommate, and then I finally got my own place, and that could have been where maybe I had like thought to subscribe to something, but I didn't, because by that point, this is like 2003, 2004, I had internet, and then I had Bear films. I had actual porn.
That's
I had
right.
Videos.
Damon
I had...
went the other way. Some of us were busy relying on print. Damon, on the other hand, was like, "I got all you bitches. I'm gonna own it on film, and I'm gonna rewind and play and rewind and play, and I'm just gonna wear the VHS motherfucker out."
Well, I didn't have the VHSs. This was at the point where it was actually DVD. Yeah, these are DVDs.
Okay.
Yeah, I don't think Bear films was around for VHS.
It was. Yeah.
Tony's like, it was.
I know I have.
That started a little later because I know like P.R. Simon, like I think Ursus, I think was old enough for that. That was a French film company.
Yeah. The I know Bear Films though had at least two, if not more, on VHS. And it could have been where it was that right in that transition period where they would offer it on VHS or DVD, and then eventually they skipped solely to DVD. I mean, now you can buy it all on, you know, it's all like downloadable, but
now it's SVOD. It's subscription VOD. You just pay a subscription. And in fact, Bear Films has a lifetime subscription. You pay like $200 and you never have to pay again.
Wait, see, David, all that money you spent over all those years, and you just could have waited and spent $200, and you would have had a lifetime subscription.
Mm.
Whose lifetime, we don't know.
Or you go to one of the porn sites and don't pay.
That. Very that.
Yes.
Although they've been kind of cracking down on it. So.
Yeah, well, I agree.
Go ahead. I do have to say that that Bear Films does not have everything of theirs on their SVOD service, because I'm trying to look for scenes from like back in the early days, and some of them are just not there.
Yeah, it's gonna be.
We'll talk offline.
Patrons probably want to pay extra for that.
But I. Yeah, but again, kind of to get back to like the magazine thing and the, you know, subscriptions and stuff. I do think that there's a nostalgia to it, you know, in a sense, you know, the idea of flipping through pages and actually having physical content. There's this whole, for lack of a better phrase, like vintage feel going around where you want like that. Like, I want to actually look through pages and actually look at a magazine and have that feeling again, maybe because I'm, again, feeling nostalgic about that, or maybe I never had the opportunity. And this feels like a really unique way to have that media. But I don't know if I would subscribe to something now. Although it's funny because we were just talking about it earlier, I did, you know, I joined that Patreon for that webcomic that I was, adult webcomic. And the main reason I did was because he was putting a lot of his stuff on Twitter. And mostly everything that he put on Twitter, he was censoring. Why, I don't know, but I think, well, actually, I do know now. Probably because, hey, I want people to go subscribe on my Patreon and see the, you know, see the full dings, full ding-a-ling, as it were. I was kind of like, I kept looking at the stuff and I was getting into the comic, and that's a whole other story. It's actually rather interesting. I'm kind of enjoying what he's doing with characters, blah, blah, blah. And then, you know, obviously it's an adult comic, so there's a sexual side to it as well. And I found myself like, I really want to see more. I want to see all what's going on. Well, the only way to do it is to fucking be a patron. And I was like, well, it's $5 a month. Mm-hmm. And there you go. I've had it for less than a week now, but I've thoroughly enjoyed it. Because you know what? What I've seen currently on his Twitter page is like from a year ago or more that he was writing. He's so far ahead on his Patreon page, and I'm seeing stuff I didn't even know was a thing. And I'm like, oh, wow, this is kind of really, you know, kind of amazing. And following characters and what have you is just intriguing to me. And I wouldn't have had an opportunity to see that if I hadn't subscribed.
Right.
Right?
You're subscribing to support it, basically.
Right.
And I think that's something that artists are doing, but we're not necessarily aware of unless they reveal it. Like, hey, I'm giving you old content. Do you know what I mean? Like right. If they don't come outright say that, then you don't realize, oh, like I'm not up to date or current or whatever.
Yeah. Like the perfect example is he was posting stuff about a Halloween like story. And that was actually the Halloween story from 2021. When I went on the page, which was because it was just around Halloween, I'm seeing his actual current Halloween story. And I was like, oh, what's going on? Oh, it's like I found the ones I wanted to see. And I see on, you know, because it's Patreon, like it's dated. And I was like, oh, that came out last year. Okay, cool. That makes sense.
Right. So I've got a really weird past with magazines and movies and things like that. So some of the folks on the call may or may not recognize me from my prior life where I had a different handle. I went by Porno Cub because, I had so much porn stored at the house because I was working straight out of college and was living at home. So I didn't have anywhere to spend my income. So I bought porn.
Oh, darn.
Yeah. Well, hey, straight out of college. What are you going to do with it? And so I had several hundred VHS tapes. I had, this was pre-DVD era, and but I also had a ton of magazines. And eventually getting involved in the bear community and things like that, having then worked on a bear run and having to work with the magazines for doing advertising and getting their support back, it was a very interesting thing to then get a different perspective of how their business worked. And the thing that I think is interesting is we kind of have a rosy memory of those magazines. If you go back and remember, they were usually black and white only. There was the occasional color page. There might be a spot color page, but usually they weren't full color. The magazines that were full color, those were usually like once a year, and the other issues would be normal. I know, for example, for the discussion for the drummer here, of like, it looks like they're releasing four times a year. It looks like, so for folks who aren't looking at the websites and haven't looked at them yet, it looked like they were talking about $30 for the digital subscription and then $80 for the physical. And that's $20 an issue for a magazine. That's really expensive. And to me, that's bordering on book level.
Right.
Right. And that's where like Tom of Finland, they're the team that handles that. They've gone with books instead of magazines.
Well, but I think that brings up a good point though, Tony, is like, yeah, it's pretty pricey if you want a print publication, but I would imagine in today's day and age, people aren't going to want a print publication to make the pages sticky.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, that might be an outcome, but I don't think that, no pun intended. I think that you are buying it because it's a collectible to you in some fashion. Like, it has some kind of, like, reverence or, you know, that's just kind of my perspective on it.
Or you want to support them.
Right.
Or you just wanting to support, yeah.
It's kind of like vinyl.
Exactly.
Like, what audiophiles would actually get vinyl? They want vinyl for the collectability of it, not because they prefer hearing things via vinyl. Maybe they do, but most of the time they're buying it as a collectible because you get the nice album art and the bigger look. Maybe they end up just framing it and putting it up on the wall. Maybe taking the actual vinyl out and they have the main thing. Maybe if it's one of those fold out ones, they have the whole thing and then they have the record underneath it.
Oh yeah.
But it's art. It's not necessarily they're going to wear it out using the needle on the old turntable. I'm not sure if any of you kids these days even understand what I'm talking about, but I mean, that's what vinyl is today, is really just collectability. Same for the magazine. So that most people, if they wanted the magazine, they might even just opt for the subscription for the combo package of digital and physical. And then when the power's out and they want to look at something bigger than their phone, which is pretty big at the time, and they don't have their tablet doesn't have a cellular connection, they can whip out the magazine and maybe use the phone as a flashlight or something if it's dark out.
Yeah, and I completely agree. As a collectible, it's something that people will buy. The only concern I'd have is like, what's the end goal there? How are you going to maintain this? Because at $20 an issue, that's really expensive to expect people to continuously subscribe. So how long until you innovate and add something new? So if like half the pages are black and white and only a couple are color, that might not keep people there. So,
but if you had a full color, like that's kind of what I'm hoping for. Like I'm not, you know, Drummer and I have a history, and I'm probably not going to, we might get into that later, but the idea of a, if it were, like you're saying, if it's $20, I'm expecting, and it's quarterly also, I'm expecting a large issue, full color, you know, articles, pages, you know, articles, several pictures, what have you. I'm going to have an expectation of more because I'm spending more. And while I understand, you know, wanting to support a LGBT organization, what have you, or a group, I still also would like to get some of my money's worth, especially when, if you're going to do this quarterly, you're going to have 3 months-ish plus to create your zine, as it were. You're going to have time. You're going to have, you know, lots of time to edit and, you know, source out photographers and source out content and develop what you want the zine specific, you know, that issue to be. You know, if you kind of keep it to, if the themes are just like the holiday, like not holidays, the seasons, then cool. But I would hope like you would have more to it than it just be random pictures of random people. Like I would want something creative in the content.
Well, and that's kind of where I was thinking of what I think would be a cool venture for them to do is, if you remember back in the day, a lot of those issues, they would have special issues. Like I have a copy of one of them. I don't think it was Drummer, but it was a Sports Gear issue. It wasn't one of the normal monthly issues. It was a special, they released a couple of them every year, and it was a separate one that you bought. And that would be, to me, the better model here of, hey, let's release 4 collectible items a year, aside from our normal publication, which is digital, we can still do the digital one, but I don't know if they're going to do the same level of quality as what I was concerned with.
Yeah.
So, I mean,
I could, I could see it being, knowing what I know, I could see it being, here's what you get. Like, it's just, it's, you know, and that's, that could be frustrating, but I also know that there would probably be people that would be, enjoy it more. And I think there's a culture of people that will really enjoy whatever is put out there. You know, one of the things I follow on, two of the things I follow on Twitter, one of them is called Vintage Smuttons.
It's a newer Twitter account that is basically posting vintage porn, not screenshots, but like images of print publication photographs,
right?
So to speak.
L&M has posted quite a few in the past too.
Yeah. Are you gonna show up? Maybe not. Of course, I'm not gonna be able to find it quickly. So, anyway, I found that recently, and I was like, oh, this is kind of cool. And I followed it mostly because I was really enjoying the content, because it was almost curated in a sense. You know, it was obviously they have a lot to go from, because there's publications from years and years ago even. And, you know, who knows what all is, you know, available digitally from those older bear or even porn magazines, what all is available now. I doubt someone, at least not recent until maybe recently, has taken the time and actually, you know, scanned their collection and made it available.
Well, it's interesting that you say that, because I came across this website called cowboyfrank.men right while we were live in this issue, where this gentleman is actually from he and his husband's collections. They have been scanning issues of Drummer Extras, Honcho, Mandate, Advocate Men, Couples, and other miscellaneous things. I'll give you guys the link here in the chat real quick. And it's not complete, but you can make donations or scan them and then send in the images and stuff, which I find really interesting about a way to preserve the previous print items.
Interesting.
Yeah, so what the new Drummer, I'm going to call it, what they're looking to do, it really seems, is bring together a lot of different things. Articles, fiction stories, photography, illustrations, which is what the magazine used to be. Right. So I can't say for certain if it's going to be all color, because I can't find that anywhere.
Lord.
But the most, in the particular issue that was the bear issue, there was 13 items. There's a comic called The Toolbox. There's a photography section called Street Sex Photos. Another one, which I think is a story called Sleep Tight, Very, Very Tight. Then there's Ursus and Otter, Mental Bondage. Apparently there's Uncut Video, which I'm like, well, that's new, because you couldn't quite do that before in print.
No.
I'm thinking this is probably a fiction story called Keep on Truckin'. There's an artist item called Big, Bigger, Best, ? Then Typologies, To Bear or Not to Bear, a short story called Hungry, and then Drummer World, Tokyo. There's an article about, as well as the article that is free to the public, you can read, called The Bear Contingent, which is what I referenced earlier that Luke had written. So it seems like they're kind of pulling a whole series of things together in that case, which I find interesting.
You're going to make me go grab the stack of Got Downstairs, aren't you?
So now, notably on what they talk about, like, you know, what they serve, they say what we stand for. Drummer seeks to inform, entertain, and inspire you, our subscribers and members, on the themes that interest you the most. Leather, sex, leather wear, leather and rubber gear, S&M, bondage and discipline, erotic styles and techniques. It's what you wear, the places you go, what you like to do, and the men you like to do it with. Our goal is to celebrate masculine gay leather sexuality that is free of misogyny, transphobia, and racism of any kind.
And Gary, did you see who wrote Hungry?
I did not recognize the name.
Story by Jeff Lavelle.
Oh! Right. I hadn't even like put two and two together. How interesting.
I did as soon as I read it.
I didn't catch the name, I honestly, or else it would have like clicked.
Huh.
And now Tony's like, who?
I don't know offhand, but
he is a previous guest we've had on the podcast. He's a writer. He's written a couple of books. He's written articles for Vice. He was episode 336 called My Three-Way Relationship.
Mm.
How interesting. So, yeah, that was 7 years ago in October of 2015.
Man.
We've been doing this for a while. Interesting. Yeah, I didn't quite catch that part. But yeah, and so they've had a change of management recently, it seems, with Drummer. I don't know if we want to get into the backstory of what's going on, but my understanding is that there has been some stuff with how things were being handled and what was going on with that. So I can understand that people might be like reluctant or, oh, hell no, in perspective. But I feel, as an outsider who doesn't really know a whole lot, that they're making an attempt to address and go in a different direction. And I don't know who this individual is, Damon or Tony. You might know who Sir Jack McCollum is by name. Uh-huh. They are the publisher and owner.
Don't know off by name.
Interesting.
But...
ooh. We may have to go offline for that conversation.
Well... well, one thing I was going to get at was it's going to be interesting to see, though, is most magazines, your subscription basically covered you receiving it. It was not covering the cost of printing. The printing costs were covered by the advertisers.
Mm.
So I don't know how this current model is going to work, because obviously they're not going to get as much from advertisers these days. So presumably more of your money is going towards paying for the printing, but... that's kind of where the trouble comes in for what I see is who is driving where the money is coming from will determine what the content is.
Mm-hmm.
So like, will you have the Mr. S episode or issue this week?
But that brings up an interesting point though, Tony, is I wonder if the high price is because of that very issue. Like magazine issue. What I mean is, like, the very item that you're bringing up is about advertising covering costs. That print alone is expensive, period. But it could be that it is an all color issue, and it could be, you know, 36, 40, 44 pages, something along those lines. And that has, you know, X factor of costs. And so they may have minimal advertising. You know, as opposed to the olden days where there was a ton of like classified ads and, you know, and print stuff and whatever. So, yeah, I don't know.
Because that was the other question I had is just like, if you do have advertisers, what are you going to advertise? Because you're going to have to advertise it 2 to 3 months in advance. So,
right.
Who these days knows what is going to go on sale 6 months from now?
Yeah, I could. It's going to be tough, but it, you know, think about what it was back in the day when you had to be really discreet about what you, who, and what you were. So, like, you could probably ask, you know, reach out to local or, you know, regional bars, especially if they follow in your kind of idea of what you want, like the Eagles as a perfect example. Mm-hmm. You know, you could very easily get them to advertise in the magazine and just promote their, you know, their bars open and what have you. Granted, you know, as you're saying, that could change depending on when they're printing the magazine. You know, you could go 3 months, and it sounds terrible, but, you know, in this economy in these days, a bar can be open in January and closed by April or March. Yeah, April. You know, it's entirely possible. You could promote bigger events that are traditional. That sounds weird. Annual. That's the word I'm looking for. You know, mm-hmm. your claws, your
IMLF shoe.
Right, right. You could you could do, you know, do that and kind of show those things even in advance to get, you know, eyes on the event. Granted, people who are probably going to those already know that they're going, but that's neither here nor there. You know, but like that's where my head is going. Like, okay, here you go. This is something you can do, or oh, here's an idea. Or, you know, if you, you know, sounds bad, but if you're connected enough, you might be able to get some, you know, make some deals and get some stuff in there to kind of cross promote. And since it's also doing a digital format as well, they have a potential of going from there. They could have direct links in the digital pages that click, you click it and you go to this website or whatever kind of thing.
But I mean, how many of us, we've all been involved with runs before, right?
I've gone to them.
Okay. Yes. But you've gone to them and gotten the free issues of whatever magazine that came.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Now, the interesting part will be is like, are they going to be in a position where they could work with, let's say, Claw and make an issue just for that?
That's a good idea.
Maybe. I mean, you know, it is interesting you bring it up, Tony, because I remember quite a while ago, they gave away free copies of the magazine or whatever. It was usually not the current magazine. It was probably just their off run, you know, whatever was left over, and be like, sure, you can have 300 copies of this or whatever. Cause then they're like, get it on our damn office. Mm-hmm. But yeah, like it was a way to introduce you into something as a print publication. I don't know. I think it's interesting you bring up, like, yeah, I could see that if you have recurring events like Claw, let me think.
IML,
damn it. Mid-Atlantic Leather.
Mal. Yeah.
Fuck. But I'm blanking on, Texas Bear Roundup, TBRU, Bear Bash, Western Exposure now is up and coming with Wes and that group. which they just announced, I think today, yesterday, last 24 hours, breaking news. They're having something they're called Eastern Exposure because they're going to be doing it in Georgia as well. As Palm Springs, I think they're actually calling it Eastern Exposure because Southern Exposure is a different thing, I think.
Maybe.
But anyways, like if you know that you have these recurring things, because the Eastern Exposure thing that I just saw got announced is next June. So if you're able to do that kind of planning 1 year out, 6 months out, then yeah, you might be interested in doing it. And if they're willing to give you, you know, a quote unquote decent rate that you think is acceptable, that could, you know, be something of interest to you. Plus, I also want to make mention, since we're talking about zines and that, Bear World Magazine celebrated 10 years.
Wow.
Right? Like, and it's funny because I don't think of it as a big player, but the fact that they made it a decade is really interesting. And I listened to a podcast interview recently with, and I want to make sure that I get the name correct, Richard Jones, who was the founder. He kind of briefly for a little while went by a different name in the beginning just because of the time and some things that were going on. But it was an interesting interview podcast where he talked about what it was like to kind of create this thing and how it's grown over the years. But I was thinking about it and I was like, wow, 10 years. Like, I remember when this kind of came around, and I hate to say it, there was a lot of things that came and went. Mm-hmm. And, you know, bear sites and different print publications and events, and you're just kind of like, meh, okay, whatever. Yeah, and you just kind of don't really give it any thought. But the fact that they're still around a decade later is, you know, really kudos to them.
Yeah.
So I think there's always been interest, you know, in our own communities and how we bring them together. And this might be another one, you know, that the leather kink community is attempting to do. What I appreciate about it is I think that they're trying to recognize, like, whatever the model was before didn't obviously work because nothing's around anymore from the previous decade. So can we adopt, like, and produce something that is of the now yet gives us that nostalgia factor, like we talked about in previous podcasts, that mm-hmm. we're interested in it, and it kind of gives us that, I remember what it was like, you know, to, you know, look at something and bait to it. And I mean, and I'll be honest about it, like a lot of the print publications I was interested in, and this comes from my upbringing, my dad collected Playboys. And right. Playboy is not really a nudie mag, or at least it wasn't in the first 50 years. Like it was, you know, it had some photography in it, but it also had a lot of like articles and interviews and stories.
Yeah.
And so, you know, and like, I mean, if you remember, what was it, Hustler and, mm-hmm. you know, the letters and that kind mm-hmm. of stuff. So when, you know, LGBT, you know, media came out, especially MSM media for print publication, there was a lot of like stories. In fact, I can't even remember what the little booklets were called. There were so many of them. I know they're leather archives and museum because I saw them in the library. I want to say it was called Coach or Daddies. Anyways, there was like all these little mini zines, basically, that came out with all these stories. And that was one of the first ways I got into like MSM smut, was like reading all of this, you know, fanfic in a way, but it wasn't really fan, it was just fiction. Mm-hmm. You know, hookups and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And I agree. I think they need to do something current. They can't redo the old model.
And right.
That's the part where I just don't know, since we don't have the magazine in front of us physically. Can't predict whether or not it's something that will approach everybody, or if this mm-hmm. is purely a you want to support and collect.
Hey, right. So I'll throw this out there, not that they're likely to listen to this podcast, but Drummer Magazine, if you're interested in throwing a free subscription our way on a digital, we would be happy to take a look, and it might answer some of our questions.
Mm.
And so I talk about the runs, but I have to give credit to the fact that a lot of the magazine publishers, so at the time when I was involved with Hibernation, we were dealing with both Bear and American Bear magazine, mm-hmm. and both of them were quite receptive. I had a whole lot more experience with American Bear because we could afford to do advertising in theirs. We couldn't afford it for Bear magazine.
Mm.
But we worked directly with them. But one of the interesting things was for the run, I actually reached out to Paz magazine.
Okay.
Because I thought it was very important to have inclusion, even though it's not a smutty magazine, et cetera.
Right.
But what was interesting was I had reached out to them like 6 months in advance. We were talking about this time frame, and they had an issue with the person who had won IML that year. They were going to feature him in the issue that would have come with the run. So we actually timed it with them that we got the magazine before it went public.
Oh, wow.
So,
well, smell you.
But I mean, it's that sort of like, it was a great thing for them because it was free press. They went to an audience that normally would never see it. Mm-hmm. And yet at the same time, we were featuring something that would interest the crowd that we had.
Mm-hmm. yeah.
Trying to find it online, but I'm not having any luck
yeah.
with a 25-year-old magazine.
Right. Yeah, I will say there were some print, I remember print mag, some of the, especially from, like, I remember from Rum Bags, and there was one, it was a smaller one, and it was Bear related, and it wasn't smutty. It was honestly just kind of tasteful. Sorry, Jim's home. It was tasteful. Like, they were never fully nude. It was obviously just, like, physical, like probably torso up pictures, maybe the occasional butt, but it was, and I can't remember the name of it. And they used to come almost with almost every Bear run I went to. They were like these, and they were little and they were free, and I cannot remember the name of it. I have to think about it for a second, but yeah, there is something interesting about that. Cause I probably would have never seen it if not for, you know, runs and people working with these, you know, publishers to get these magazines or these what have you, so that they could be distributed. Like, so who knows?
Right. Yeah. So, I mean, I think the point of this discussion was simply like, how do we feel about this potential landscape of a return to magazines, but understanding there will be a digital component to it. You know, if you go to visit the website, there is like, you know, from the bare issue, two articles that are free. Everything else is behind a paywall for a subscription, which is fair. You know, they're giving a little bit of a taste of what, you know, is in there and understanding, and you can kind of look around and that stuff. But then they, you know, kind of draw the line at that, which I think is, you know, reasonable for, you know, what they're attempting to do. Let me take a look here because I'm intrigued, because you actually also have back issue articles. Yeah, most of them are probably behind the paywall. Mm-hmm. So, but, you know, I mean, there's a part of me that's like, I don't think $30 is unreasonable for a digital subscription for a year. That's $7.50 an issue. If it's four times a year.
Mm-hmm.
And if it's good content, and I guess that's really where the question mark is for us collectively, and what I'm hearing, if it's good content, then I won't care about paying $7.50.
Mm-hmm.
And good content being not just like porn, but like thoughtful articles, engaging interview, you know,
right.
You know, some, you know, stuff about the art within the, you know, the leather scene, that kind of stuff. And it would make sense that this would come about kind of now, because I really see that there's a vitality within the leather community that is of interest about, like, we need to have a discussion. We have to own our past,
mm-hmm.
and make a new future going forward from that, and what that will end up being, you know, potentially for everybody.
Right.
And they are doing a little bit of multimedia too, because they've got a page there for media. Mm-hmm. And it says music, videos, and podcast. Apparently, they're doing a monthly podcast.
I wonder if they would be interested in like having a discussion with another podcast.
Maybe.
I'll make sure to reach out to you, Tony, if that happens.
Oh, definitely. But yeah, I mean, I think the magazines being reprinted, coming back out, could be a very good thing as far as like collectibles, supporting the groups, etc. But yeah, without seeing them, I couldn't tell you for sure. And like, mm-hmm. I mentioned, the Tom of Finland, like, they released a book, and it's right now on Amazon for about $60 of their the Tom of Finland artwork, but it's, mm-hmm. in a full color, like, printed book type thing that you would put on a coffee table. So that's where of like more like the Patreon type stuff of, do you save it up and produce a book once a year, or, and like for the digital subscription, do you get back issues? I mean, how is that handled?
Well, that's a good question. I'm going to throw this out there. I would expect, if I pay my $30 for the digital subscription, I would automatically get full access to the back catalog. Right. Now, the back catalog for me would be what they've produced recently. Like, I wouldn't expect them to give me everything that's ever existed from Drummer. Like, that would be cool, but I think that's excessive. I think it would make sense if they've been doing it for just a couple of years now, for maybe like 10 or so issues.
So like the Patreon model that we were talking about earlier.
Yeah. I think that would be fair.
Yeah. And I think that would be very great too. Just don't know.
I
really feel like, you know, hey, Jack, anybody over at Drummer, if you would like to give us some insights on your stuff, then, you know, we'd be happy to discuss some more.
Right. Well, and even the folks over at Bear World, for example. I mean, what have they been doing that's been successful for 10 years?
Right.
Wow. Okay. So this is an attitude. I'm on the website and I'm just kind of clicking links randomly, like looking at all sorts of stuff. So they have a link called Tough Customer Application. Is this, wait, is it all one or is it? Yeah, it's all one. And it says, "Do you have what it takes?" And then I'm about to quote, like, obviously our podcast is not for anybody underage, but this is the description part. It says, "Yeah, fuckface, scroll that phone of yours and find those filthy photos of you and your gear to show the world what you're made of. Make sure to include a blurb to tell us what you like, smell like, what you get off, or whatever else you think people will give a fuck about."
Huh.
So that's an attitude.
It kind of reminds me of their classic. They used to have, I was going to say one ads, but that's not the word I'm looking for. Personal ads. In like drummer used to have personal ads where you would, you know, because again, back in the day, it was one of the few ways you had to connect with people. So you had these ways of connecting with other people through these ads that you would put out there. Maybe with the picture, maybe not with the picture.
I think that's kind of what they're doing because it says tough customers, name, first, last, name to use in the TC listing, which is a requirement, email, drummer bio, and then you upload an image. It gives you some stuff to know and that the image must be in portrait dimension, meaning taller than wider in order to fit their layout.
Interesting.
And a consent. Okay. I consent to drummer using my photo and associated information. So there may be a whole section we're not even aware of that they're doing. I don't know. Like, they haven't really listed that anywhere.
Tony has stepped away from his computer.
I'm still here.
But you've stepped away from your computer.
Of course.
He had to go looking at his print copies.
Right.
So, and they actually do have retailers listed. One, two, three locations in California, one in Florida, one in Illinois, one in New York. One in Quebec, Canada, one in the Netherlands. So it is possible to become a retailer of their print publication.
Interesting.
Okay, yeah, I can't show any of these on the screen.
I had a feeling you couldn't. We'd have to wait until post show.
I mean, I've got some of the old advocates, for example.
Ah, oh, wow.
Let's see, 1984.
Wow.
No, basically these are a stack of magazines I've been saving to take up to L&M.
Yeah.
Like there's a Frontiers from 83.
Frontiers, there's one I haven't heard in quite a while. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but I mean there's all kinds of ones you had. Out magazine.
Mm-hmm.
And these are the ones that I'm going to have to kind of like limit, but like stroke.
Kind of like boop.
Yeah, holding my hand over the questionable areas.
Uh-huh.
But yeah, no, I mean, the magazines have come a long way.
Yeah. Yeah. That's a great way to put it. I think I have, I mean, after we're done, I may run upstairs to, because I think I remember where I have something.
There's another stack down there. I just didn't have hands to carry both stacks.
It's all good.
Yeah. In fact, I know I will probably end up donating my Bear magazine collection if they don't have the full collection. There is a print LGBTQ archive in Chicago. I can't quite remember what the name of it is. I know that our local print newsletter publication that is about to celebrate 30 years next month has been submitting stuff to them for their archive for quite some time now. So I was thinking just now, I was like, oh, it's like I could donate it to L&M, but it's not exactly in their wheelhouse. So
yeah, I don't think the Strokes would be in their wheelhouse, but
it never hurts.
I'm sure I would find somebody who would take them off my hands.
Right. Bazinga.
Very true.
Oh. I don't think there's anything else. Or do we? Is there anything else?
I'm good.
Nope. I don't think so. And with that, that's the end of the show. Oh. Plenty of ways to contact us. And if you would like links to all this, well, at least the Drummer Mag links, you can pop over to our website, cubsoutloud.com, where you can leave a comment on the blog and interact with our links. You can also shoot us an email at cubsoutloud@gmail.com or leave us a voicemail, 361-COL-TALK. That's 361-265-8255. You can follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube at Cubs Out Loud in the appropriate place of the URL. Don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe. And ding that bell for notifications when we go live.
Ding!
Ding! If you would like to chat us up directly, you can chat with all four of us, actually, are in there. At tinyworld.com/telegram-col. You can also find out when we're planning on recording these shows and what we're planning on recording by checking out our Google Calendar at tinyworld.com/calendar-col. You can subscribe. Also get various accoutrements, such as a Cubs Out Loud hat, a Cubs Out Loud shirt, some Consent is My Foreplay shirt designed by Smashy at zazzle.com/Cubs Out Loud. Speaking of which, Smashy has some other designs, which you can find more of his work at tpublic.com/user/SmashyTheBear. You can also become a patron at patreon.com/CubsOutLoud or send us a donation at paypal.me/CubsOutLoud. Please stop over at your favorite podcast directory, Apple Podcasts, Google Play, Amazon, Audible, Spotify. You'll find us there. Make sure to subscribe. Rate and review us, because that will put us higher in the algorithm. You can find me anywhere on the internet as Box Puppy Box Cub Box something or other and Windgem WYNDGEM on Twitch, where I string bears and dragons.
If you wish to get in touch with me, you can find me as TheaterCub79. That's TheaterCub79. Almost bear related sites are on Facebook. Or you can find me as pup_umbra on Twitter. The Twitter is definitely not safe for work.
If you would like to get in touch with me, you can pretty much find me anywhere online as GearBear73. And Mr. Tony, a.k.a. Cubziz, if people were to find you online or get in touch with you, how would they do so?
Twitter online is Cubziz. I don't even remember if my Facebook is still Cubziz or not, but I barely use Facebook these days. But that's Twitter's easiest.
Mm-hmm.
Until it goes down in flames.
Well,
I think we'll be okay.
Okay, fine. You can go to my Tumblr.
Well, I don't know about that. With that, take it out, everybody.
Good night, everybody.
Ciao for now.